Thank you very much, Keith Bird, for the opening prayer. That was Keith Bird. He's the Cultural Arts Advisor for Sagiawak Artists Collective. Good evening, everyone. My name is Chris Najakoti. I'm the host and producer of CTV's Indigenous Circle. And welcome to a special edition of Indigenous Circle. We have cameras there. We have cameras there. We have I'm kidding. It's good to have all of you here. How about a big round of applause for all of you for being here tonight? Four lovely ladies here this evening that's going to be accompanying me, and I'm going to help try my best to be moderator for tonight. So I'm not going to try to cut them off because they'll probably pull me aside later. I'm kidding. But we're going to have fun tonight. Just a little housekeeping rules here. I just got to go through some things here just for the organization tonight. We would like to start by expressing our gratitude for the land we stand on and acknowledging that we are guests on Treaty 4 territory, the traditional territory of the Cree, Soto, Nakota, Lakota, and Nakota peoples, and the homeland of the Métis people. Sagiawak's Sask Culture, Saskatchewan Arts Board, and Sask Writers Guild would like to thank their sponsors who have made the panel discussion possible. This includes the Federation of Sovereign Indigenous Nations, RESX, who is right here with Chris Rosser in front of us here, and the City of Regina. And by the way, before I get to this next paragraph here, we are live streaming this, so if you want to follow the Sagiawak Facebook page or tell your friends to follow along, we are live streaming this right now. That's why the computer and the cameras are here right now. So if anybody that couldn't make this event can go on Facebook and watch what we're doing here right now. We'd also like to thank the sous chef who will be providing refreshments this evening during our break, and the Regina Performing Arts Center who are our hosts this evening. Thank you, Regina Performing Arts Center and the sous chef. This evening we'll begin with a brief introduction from each of our panelists, followed by a few moderated questions from myself. At 8 p.m. we'll take a short 15-minute break to enjoy refreshments and return back here at 8:15 sharp for an audience Q&A. Before we begin the discussion on cultural appropriation, it is important to understand and respect our panelists' boundaries. The panelists have the right to pass on a question they may not feel comfortable answering in front of an audience. As well, we'd like to remind everyone to be mindful and respectful of how much time and space you're taking, and to leave room for our invited guests, the panelists, to answer questions. I'd also like to invite audiences to read your brochures for detailed bios on each of the panelists at this time. So all the bios are there if anybody wants to know any more information about that. At this time, we'll ask the panelists to do a brief introduction of who they are, where they're from, and what they're currently working on. So, Janet, I'll start with you. Who you are, where you're from, and what are you currently doing right now?
Thank you. Hi, everybody. My name is Janet Rogers, Sagoskanagaw. That means in Mohawk, do you have the peace with you? Do you have the peace with you? Are you peaceful? Your mind is peaceful. And I am from Six Nations territory in Southern Ontario, and I live on traditional Coast Salish territory, which is also known as Victoria, BC, and I've been out in on the West Coast for 23 years, and I'm very happy to be here on Treaty 4, so thank you for hosting me here on Treaty 4. I am a writer, primarily, and I was a Victoria's Poet Laureate for 3 years, 2012 to 2015. I had a blast doing that gig. That was fun. And I have 5 books, and also I work in media. So I'm one half of Two Row Media, which I run with Jackson Two Bears, who is also from Six Nations, Kanyangahega. And we have been in our media business for about 3 years now. And I'm very happy to be on this panel. There's a few things that, as a writer, Indigenous writer, I think I'll have to say about this topic. So I look forward to it. Thank you.
Thank you, Ani Bojo, Kiwait and Kwe and Dishnikas. My name is Michelle Valley. I'm a curator. I work at the Kenzie Art Gallery here in Regina. Also a mom, a beautiful 4-year-old. I'm not from this territory. I'm from Ontario region. Bios are on the table if you want to know more about me, I guess.
Hi, my name is Trudy Stewart, and I'm from Flying Dust First Nation. But I adopted out, so I spent most of my life in Treaty 4 in Regina, and I'm a filmmaker. My partner and I did a documentary on the Regina Indiana Industrial School, and I'm really happy today because we just received provincial designation for the cemetery that we've been fighting to protect. I started a project about 3.5 years ago, so it's been a lot of work with a lot of people, and it's been really great working together with them to get to that point. But I also have a short documentary called From Up North that's currently on the festival circuit. It screened in New Zealand last month, and it's screening in Ottawa next month. And I have a telephone micro-budget project that's going ahead that we're shooting with my partner, Roxanne Whitebean, in Gunawage this winter. So I'm looking forward to that. And I'm doing a number of different short documentaries in the area this summer.
Hello, everyone. My name is Audrey Drever. I am Plains Cree from the Mistawasis Cree Nation. My family comes from Mistawasis, Etakakut, and Ermineskin in Alberta. I am an artist, painter and sculptor. I'm also a curator, a Native art history instructor at the universities here in Regina, and I'm also an art and museum consultant that works with exhibit development, collections care, the care of Indigenous collections, issues around repatriation. So I do a lot of things. My consulting work is my primary focus these days, and it's really based a lot on, well, not a lot, it's based entirely on Native art history, our histories from pre-contact to contemporary times, and not just of North America, but Central and South America as well. Appropriation, this topic tonight, is no matter what kind of work I do, there's an aspect of that I have to work through or deal with. And as a teacher, it's one of the things that I make sure is incorporated into the classes that I teach. So I'm happy to be here. I have a lot of issues, I'll let you know that right now. And I have no problem speaking about them, the good and the bad, and really looking critically at what it is that we're navigating our way through. So thank you everyone who have brought us together, have supported it, and thank you to Creason and the panelists for being a part of this with me.
Thank you very much, ladies. And you probably recognize them on TV. I've done at least many stories with the three over here to my far right as well. So I guess first off, my first question for the four of you tonight is, when I think about cultural appropriation in the news, I guess, just in terms of my job, I think about the Walmart onesie that was on Twitter over the couple weeks here. I think about the Old Navy t-shirt. I also think about fashion designers taking art from art designs from Inuit ceremonies and then putting it on the runway later in Paris or somewhere. So in terms of cultural appropriation, what comes to your mind, Janet?
When I live in Victoria, as I said, and if you can imagine, the Victoria is the land of totem poles and Northwest Coast art. And that style of art is very distinct to the nations and the regions there in the Northwest Coast. And so this, because of its distinctiveness, because of its collectability, because of its beauty, and because of its association with tourism, these designs get reproduced, and not by necessarily Indigenous people. And so when it was as recently as last summer, in a you know, a public market like you guys had today, I went down to the market today, a beautiful market you have. In one of my markets in Victoria, there was a fellow who had a coloring book, and it was all Northwest Coast designs. And I did a double take, because he's clearly, to me, he was clearly not Native, and so I approached him, like one-on-one, like a human being. And I asked him if he was of the Northwest Coast, and he said no, and he said, oh, these designs are inspired by, and that word is problematic. because it's almost a word overused to allow yourself, to give yourself permission to basically steal other designs. So I see this quite a lot. I see it a lot in my personal life as a, you know, as a consumer of art myself, and I see it a lot as a writer, a native writer, and I hear, you know, whenever I see stories that are written, that have native content and they're not written by native people, I really want to find out what the story is behind that story. What kind of relationship does that person have? And what makes them feel they have the right to write that story? And for example, as recently as yesterday, I picked up the BC Book World, and it's a lovely free publication that gives you the scoop on all the BC-based writers. And they do cover a lot of Indigenous writers. I have to give them credit for that. However, there's one book that's just come out now. The author is Gary Giddies. I Name Names. And the title of his book is Medicine Unbundled or something like this. Anyways, he's telling the story of a woman from the Salish territory, Joni Morris, and Joni's family, and she had attended the Indian hospitals. They had Indian hospitals in Nanaimo on Vancouver Island. And you know, he asked me actually to help him. I hope this not be too long. Anyways, he asked me to help him promote that book at UVic, and I said, I'm absolutely friggin' not gonna help you promote that book because I don't know what your relationship is to Joni. And he, you know, it was a back and forth. We had a lot of emails back and forth, and he explained himself and da da da. And I said, well, how did you even get to the point where you wanted to write this story? How did you find Joni? He said, oh, well, I went to the TRC hearings. And I'm pretty sure he went there with a fishing pole and a wide net because he was looking for those stories. And for that, I think that's indefensible because it's not his story. When a non-Native person writes a story of that caliber and with that content, to me, it turns into and ultimately results in trauma porn. So knock it off.
Michelle, that's a lot to get in line for, I guess, for the next speaker. But what are your thoughts about cultural appropriation?
What she said. I guess in the context of working as a curator, of course, I think of all those things. You know, the headdresses on runway models, and you know, stereotype names on sports teams, and you know, it's. I guess I was trying to think about why we're here and. I think we're here because I think there's a spectrum of appropriation, and it's kind of easy to pinpoint what's on one end and what's on the other end, but it's that gray area in between, and I think it is kind of difficult to determine and articulate exactly what it is at times, but it's important that we do that, and transgressions are being called out more and more frequently, which is important, but I also think it's important that we acknowledge that this is a decades-old problem. That's just gradually being understood. We still don't really understand it. We kind of understand why it happens because we're in a colonial system, so it's just kind of, that's another thing. But in terms of artists, I'm looking at, when I think of appropriation, I'm thinking when an artist is using something, whether it's a style, a history, a story, a tradition, maybe ceremonial references, ideals, or teachings, and they're adapting these, but they're doing it in a way that makes people, they're doing it without consulting people, without consulting the community from which they're borrowing from. They're not from that community, they haven't been gifted that. Those are the things that I'm trying to be conscious of. I wasn't sure the type of questions we'd be asked tonight, but I was asked, somebody heard I was gonna be on this panel, like, well, would you work with an artist who's appropriating? And I might. I wouldn't say yes, I wouldn't say no, it depends. So for me, it's a case by case thing. It is very, it's not cut and dry. Some cases are very cut and dry, but I might also work with an artist who's very blatantly, ignorantly appropriating, even knowingly, just to kind of draw attention to that. I hope I would err on the side of not doing that to give it more power. But it is complex, and I do think it's an important discussion that needs to be had, and not just, you know, I don't want to just hear from the four of us up here, I think it's important, you know, everybody who's in the room, I'm really happy to see the variety of people in the room, and I think it's important that we continue these conversations.
Judy.
Okay, I'm going to just speak for my discipline because I can't speak to visual arts or anything like that. To me, it's when people from outside of a community come in and just take the story without any meaningful engagement. I'm also a festival programmer, so there are a lot of Indigenous film festivals where the key creative people have to be First Nations. And there's a lot of Indigenous film festivals where other works by non-Indigenous people are screened as well. And we're one of those festivals that we screen non-Indigenous works. But in it's kind of a case-by-case thing, and the things that have made us want to screen it is because we know the level of engagement was very meaningful. One example I'll give is The Pass System by Alex Williams. And actually Shawnee and Pete, Dr. Pete, who you know everybody in this area knows, approached us and said, we worked very closely with this guy, he's doing it in the right way, and we really, really enjoyed his film a lot. And a lot of people came away from that, learning a whole lot about history that that is forgotten, you know, the whole pass system with where people had to get permission to even leave the reserve and all of the things, like, for example, when they would go to get a pass to go take their grain to the local grain elevator, there was a line for First Nations people and there was a line for white people, and the First Nations people had to sit there and wait until the end of the day until all of the white farmers were done. And if they didn't get to, you know, take their wheat in, they had to go back and do that all over again. So we screened that because we knew that, you know, Dr. Pete is somebody that we trust, and if she says this guy is doing it right, you know, we'll screen it. And there have been others that we've screened just because we know the training that was given was very, not just because I find sometimes when non-Indigenous people train Indigenous media artists, it's very much like training them to do low-level things for, you know, other people, or you know, this is how you work for the man. And so the one non-Indigenous person that we had honored because they were leaving the community because of the film employment tax credit getting axed, because he trained First Nations people and he did it in a way that was, you guys are going to be your own boss one day, so you're going to need to do all of this. And it was, you know, totally transparent with his budgets and had, and really, really trusted them with their feedback and used their feedback, you know. So to me, cultural appropriation is when somebody comes in and takes stories or kind of uses Indigenous talent to for their own good.
So we got about 36 more minutes, so I know the questions are the answers can be a little bit long, but we're just gonna have to kind of keep it tight in terms of, I got about three or four more questions for you to go through. So, Audrey.
For me, cultural appropriation is when something is taken, something that belongs to a culture, to their history, to their belief system, to their identity, is taken by someone from outside that culture, and it's used how they feel they want to use it, or they're inspired to use it, or they feel this is the best representation of that culture that I'm, even though I'm not a part of, I'm representing in this work anyway. And doing that without actually engaging with the people from the culture, without asking anyone, is this okay? Without understanding the inherent meaning that is embedded in all those art objects, those art disciplines and techniques, because they are filled with, they are mnemonic devices. They are filled with meaning. Every piece that's ever been made in the history of Native art, over 10,000 years of making art in the Americas, has been made with meaning, for purpose, for reason. And for someone of another culture to come along and say, oh, I'm so inspired, I want to do that, I'm going to make that, and then they do, and then they sell it, or exhibit it in galleries that indigenous artists from those cultures can't get into, that's, to me, that's cultural appropriation. That is being inconsiderate, it's being selfish, and it is being something that is so far removed from what I was raised to believe. It would be like me going and deciding, oh, I know this Chinese woman, I went to school with her, so I'm going to take the Chinese art because I really love this style of art. And I'm going to make all my work in this form and I'm going to show it, and because, you know, I love the Chinese art, everybody's going to understand Chinese people and Chinese art more now because I'm making this work because I love it. I can't imagine, I wasn't raised that way. I wasn't raised to think that way. And I just have a really difficult time understanding where someone's mind has to be to be okay with that. So to me, that's what cultural appropriation is about and what it does. Some of what it does.
Thank you very much. Sticking to your topic, Audrey, you know, I'm just throwing this question out here because when you talked about that just now, you know, I thought about the artist on the East who was inspired by Norvo Morisot, you know, a famous indigenous artist, and she was all over the news for taking these styles of art, and then Morisot's family came forward and said she has no right to go and do this, and she was going to Toronto and everything. In terms of this topic, this discussion, that specific case, what are your, I guess, just your thoughts about just that alone? Real briefly, we'll get to the next question after.
Yeah, that's Eastern Woodland style art, and there was a school that was birthed by Morisot to, you know, perpetuate that style of art that represents the Eastern Nation people. And when, you know, I saw this artist, what is his name, PK something or other?
Amanda
Piel. Amanda Piel, whatever. That, you know, this is just another example of how much in 2017 that we could, you know, have all of this awareness and all of these discussions about cultural appropriation for eons, as you've mentioned, decades, and still somebody will come along and think that that's perfectly fine. So it's a colonial mindset, and that thing is so hard to penetrate, man. That's the enemy.
Michelle.
Yeah, well, I think in that case, I don't know. In that case, as Audrey mentioned, it's that style of art. It isn't just simply a style. It, you know, it's become a language. It's part of a long history. There's other connotations within that, and it is really ignorant to just come in and, you know, take something and not acknowledge it. I think she may have been acknowledging, you know, the inspiration of Norval Morisot, but when it's being pointed out to you, and then you're still refusing to acknowledge that you're, it's affecting people in a negative way. I think that's irresponsible, and yeah, I don't really want to talk more about it because I don't think it's just bad art. For me, it's a non-issue. It shouldn't have even been talked about.
Truly.
Actually, these ladies said it better than I probably could, so I'll just hand it over to Audrey.
Yeah, Amanda Peel. Speaking about bad art. and I think that the fact that the art is not strong is because there is not a connection. There's not a cultural connection to somebody else's cultural signifiers. You don't understand it. So when you paint it, they're just shapes. It turns out to be just shapes. And to me, that is something that we really need to look at. So I'm also a curator. And I work with museums and some galleries developing exhibits. And another example of this kind of work is the Jimmy Durham exhibit that's coming to the Remy Modern next year. Jimmy Durham is, there's only one exhibit happening in Canada, and it's happening at Saskatchewan's brand new gallery that's owned by the city of Saskatoon, who is creating, they're in the middle of this I Am a Bridge campaign that is looking at finding ways for reconciliation. And Jimmy Durham's work is has been for over 20 years touted as being Cherokee work, and there is absolutely no Cherokee ancestry in that man. And that's been proven. But the galleries, three galleries in the States, and now the Remy Modern in Saskatoon, are all ignoring what the Cherokee people are saying, what the Cherokee Nation of the United States are saying. And they're accepting that work and presenting it as Native artwork. So when I think about the whole issue of how this, it's a complex issue. It really is. And there may be some cases, like Michelle commented about, where as a curator, I might work with somebody who's using someone else's style, depending on what approach they're taking and how connected they are to the community. So the whole issue of non-Native people pretending to be, and then getting the gallery and selling the work, to me is that colonial mindset. It is a part of that. And it's something that we have to address, especially in the case of issues around reconciliation. And that's the new big buzzword, reconciliation here and there. You know, so if people are serious about that, like the city of Saskatoon, like the government of Canada, who has just recently acknowledged that they have accepted all the terms of the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, which protects Indigenous peoples' arts and culture from appropriation and copyright infringement, then they need to step up and actually do what they say they're going to do.
Thank you very much. So what I'm getting from the four of you is that there are some people out there doing this in a respectful manner, doing it in a certain way in terms of the film, the documentarian, I guess, or whatever, that he's done it in the right way, very respectful way, and he's helping in the community. So there's a certain way. So the question I have for you is the next one here is, where do non-Indigenous artists, writers start to engage with other cultures? Should they remain separate? That's my next question for the four of you. I wonder who can answer it.
Well, as a Haudenosaunee person, we come from a two-row agreement, and that two-row agreement is very much a you do your thing over here, we're going to do our thing over here, and never shall we interfere or interrupt with each other's thing. And when I was reading at a literary festival in Campbell River, for example, people in the audience had asked, they said, well, when can a non-Native person tell another, you know, a Native person's story? And my answer was times four, never. Never, 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 never. And the reply to that, every reply to that after my answer was, yeah, but what if, and all, so for the rest of the discussion, it was all these gray area scenario responses to me saying never, 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 never. So, but that didn't seem to sit well with people. People don't want to be told they can't in anything. And I just don't believe in the gray area.
Michelle, what are your thoughts on that?
Lots of thoughts. Question again, non-Indigenous artists, when can they engage? Well, I think the issue, just to summarize what we've all said here, was, you know, the issue is when an artist is appropriating something and has made no effort to consult with community. We also talked about borrowing or taking things out of context, or that's more dispossessed. So within that context, I think what you're asking is, you know, if we're at a point where supposedly privileged artists, probably white privileged artists, should not speak to the experiences and histories of those who are not white privileged. Probably, yes. I think in most cases we probably are at that point, but it is complicated. Because again, you know, I think it comes back to what's critical to gauge it by is evidence of respect, you know, consultation, partnerships, and when you're actually, it's like a two-way partnership when you're working with people that they're named, acknowledged, compensated, and that you're not using it as a stepping stone or benefiting from it when it's very obvious that other people are trying to get into that or abusing your privilege. I don't know if I think I feel like I'm going in a circle here, but I'll just leave it at that for now.
Okay, well, like I said, it depends on the level of respect, and a really difficult lesson that I learned making films with people who are non-Indigenous is that you need to be actively involved in every aspect of planning and everything like that, because if you run into a situation where you know, people can have the best of intentions, but there's always a default. There's like this deeply, deeply ingrained default that they will always go to. And so what I learned is that you have to be very proactive in having a hand in developing projects and make sure that if anything happens, you're able to help yourself. We had with the documentary, a very difficult situation where increasingly this team member was more and more and more disrespectful. And what he had said was, the white people are going to want to hear from me, another white person, not you guys. So that's what I'm doing here. I'm here to explain to the white people what it is you're doing. And he said, well, thanks to residential school, we all speak English, so we don't need a translator. Bye. And, you know, we had to actually fight very hard to remove this person. But I just want to, you know, for any young artists out there that are starting out, you have power. And if something doesn't feel respectful, you can always do something to change that. And if you have to get funders involved and everything like that, then do that. So that's, I've had very difficult lessons working with non-Indigenous people. So it's, and I will continue to I will never give that power away where I'm just working for somebody. I don't work for people, I work with people. And so I hope that you all know that you have power.
So much to say, so little time. Okay, this is a really complex issue, and I'm just not sure how to cut it down, so I'm gonna give you three real quick examples. Because I believe collaboration is key, but it has to be respectful, balanced collaboration. I'm gonna give you a couple of examples that I've experienced, or I know of. When I did my BFA in Santa Fe, New Mexico, at the Institute of American Indian Arts, I had a reception. I shared a gallery with another student. We were both finishing our painting degrees. A non-native photographer from Santa Fe, who was building quite a reputation for herself, was hired to document the reception. She went into the gallery before the reception started, took full frame shots of all of our paintings. 2 days later, they were on her website, copyrighted as her photographs. I got in touch with the school and the photographer, and I told them that if they didn't remove them immediately, and that the school didn't protect our copyright, that I would sue them both. They were down within an hour. I was helping to curate, while I was in Santa Fe, I was helping to curate a large exhibition of Native artwork, Native student artwork from tribal colleges across the states. Along came one of the students from Blackfoot College in Montana, and he happened to be a 7 foot tall, or well, 6.5 foot tall. He looked 7 feet from my height. 6.5 foot tall Austrian guy who was as pale as a Caucasian, I think, could be. But he claimed Blackfoot status. And he insisted that his work was be registered as Blackfoot. We couldn't do that legally. And then he proceeded to tell us that we were all making the wrong kind of art and that we should be doing the old style art because that was the real Indian art. Those are two examples of no collaboration. This third example is something that I'm really proud that I've actually gotten a chance to become aware of, and that's with Christy Belcourt. She was approached by Valentino, the Italian designer, to use her beautiful floral paintings in his dresses. And he collaborated with her. A fair, amicable collaboration. And now her dresses may be worth $10,000, his dresses with her artwork on it may be worth $10,000 or more per dress. But she's been compensated and they did it on her terms, terms that they came to a balanced agreement on. To me, that's what has to be done. If non-Indigenous people are going to be working in those areas, they have to come to the table in an honest, sincere, and collaborative way, or it's not going to work.
Really briefly here, we got about 16 minutes left, but I'm going to go back to the second question, I guess. One of the major components in regards to appropriation has been accountability. You talked about it a bit here, but really briefly, I just want you to talk about it again. Who are you? Each of you have different mediums and different professions, but who are you accountable to in terms of your mediums, your professions, and what you do every day on a day-to-day basis? Real briefly.
Yeah, really briefly. I appreciated what the person who delivered the prayer today had said. We are accountable to Creator. Of course we are. And I always ask the question, why? So when I'm producing work collaboratively with my media partner Jackson Two Bears, and he plays the part of director, and I'm the producer, and he'll give a direction, and I always say why. And the reason why I'm asking why is because I know that what we're producing right now, what we're doing currently, we're creating culture, and I am responsible for what that culture looks like for future generations. And I don't want to mess it up. I don't want to be like lax about it or lackadaisical about it. This is meaningful, real stuff. And I take that responsibility very seriously.
Michelle.
Who am I accountable to? Myself, my family, my community, all of you. You know, in a public position, so yeah, I'm accountable to a lot of people, and there's a lot of pressure, but I'm very fortunate to know, like, if I mess up, it's going to be pointed out to me, and pretty quickly, I'll probably have some texts when I get home, like, you said what? So it's, but I think that's a good thing. I think that's a strength as well, you know. Usually I'm told in a nice way if I've messed up, which I appreciate, but yeah, I think we're all responsible for ourselves, and when it comes to appropriating or incorporating other cultures into something you're doing or working with individuals who might be doing that, I think the question you always have to ask is why? You know, why is this a story I feel I need to tell? You know, why? Why do I need to do this? And always self-checking.
Well, I work a lot in documentary, and the one thing about documentary is that there are times where you have to step back and ask, am I telling this person's story? Or am I exploiting or objectifying them in any way? And so the people who I'm accountable to are the people who are great and grateful enough that they share their stories with me. And I'm also grateful that I have a really good elder that I always run everything past. And you know, I'm always grateful for all the feedback. So yeah, basically the communities that I work with and you know, whoever I'm collaborating with.
Andre.
Myself first and foremost, I think. Maintaining my own integrity, because I can get judgy sometimes too. And I don't want to be seen as a hypocrite. I want to know that I've done the best I can and done it with a good heart in a good way. I'm also accountable to my kids and my grandkids, because if I have a reputation that gets tainted, they're going to be impacted, and I don't want that. I'm accountable to the people who's, when I'm working with exhibits, the people who are trusting me with their stories and their objects, their material culture that represent those stories. As a teacher, I'm accountable to the students. And most of my classes, Native Art History 100, it's a general elective, so I get students from all disciplines, and because it's an elective and they think it's going to be an easy elective. Then they get in my class. They find out different. But I'm accountable to them to make sure that they understand that there was a history, that those objects are meaningful, and that they have to understand the complex nature of what we're working through, including appropriation, respectful interaction with that art. And I think I'm accountable to, sorry, to our ancestors, to the ones who made those art pieces, that I can use to identify my place in this world, the advanced knowledge systems that were here, and what they left us.
Thank you, Angie. We got about 11 minutes. Should be enough time, eh? Last question I have for the night for you, before we get the Q&A from the audience, is in a perfect world free of appropriation, what does it look like to reclaim all that has been appropriated? What does that look like?
Well, let's think of a world that, you know, didn't have contact, and what we would be producing if we didn't have contact. Because that's, to me, that's the world that would be free of appropriation. And right now it's just too late, I think, to ask that question and maybe even to imagine what it would be like. I mean, you know, there's, I don't want to go back on anything that I said, but, you know, it would be, I think it is, it's a difficult thing to kind of comprehend what, without these tools, without this, you know, without these materials, without this reality, what it is we would be producing. And I think what we're producing now, like I said, it's the result of that contact. So I really can't even imagine.
Yeah, I think I have to agree. I think I don't know if that's possible. I don't even know if I would want that. You know, we live in a time and we work in a field where ideas and images are continually borrowed or shared or reinvented, and you know, these things pass between cultures, you know, or move back and forth across cultures throughout history, and I think that's a good thing. It's just, it becomes a problem when it's done in inappropriate ways, you know, taken or used out of context. So I think that's kind of what I'm interested in, is navigating those gray areas. And yeah, there's a lot we haven't touched upon, but I've only got a few minutes.
Yeah, it's really difficult to imagine that kind of world. But one thing that with Indigenous people getting film cameras and video cameras into their hands is telling the stories and humanizing us and our struggles. I don't know how many of you have seen Angry Inuk, but what really strikes me about that story is that it's told from within the community. It's told from Alethea grew up in the community that she filmed in, and the trappers that she talked to, or the hunters, were her next door neighbors that she had known for years. So I think what's exciting to me that so many First Nations people, in their communities, picking up cameras is telling those stories, because there's a real training from the media to not see us as human beings. And so for me, I'm very hopeful for the future, because I think that more stories are coming out and more points of view. And I mean, even 20 years ago, how many of us would know what's going on in the Inuit community, and how they hunt and how devastating the seal ban was for them. So I'm very grateful for brave storytellers like that who take the stories. And yeah, so I don't know if that answered the question, but I'm just, we didn't have cameras 100 years ago, so it's a brand new thing. So for me, it's just humanizing us and to the rest of the world.
Audrey.
In my perfect world, we'd have all our stuff back.
That's what I'd like to see.
I don't know that it's possible, but give us our stuff back. Give us our culture back, because those objects are our identity. They are our history. They are our connection to the world. And like I said, I don't know that it would ever happen, but I think a perfect world would also include having access to those material objects that are all mnemonic devices. They all represent the things that are vital to learning and being educated in who you are. Have access available to all the youth, to all the people who, the adults who haven't learned about what we have and who we are through those art pieces, because they were taken from us. And to have them interpreted by us only, so that, and accepted, that interpretation is accepted by the non-Native community. They still don't accept our, like Tracy gave an example of that, Trudy gave an example of how the one filmmaker came along to interpret because he was the white guy and the white people wanted to hear from the white guy. We still struggle with them letting go and people not wanting to hear from us, but instead preferring to hear from non-Native people from their own culture who don't know who we are, who don't know our histories. So give us back our stuff. Let us tell our stories and educate everybody with those objects, because they contain that history that's so important and so amazingly beautiful.
Thank you very much. We got about 4 minutes and 50 seconds left. I'm really counting down tonight.
Wow.
Sticking to the clock. My last question I have, you might kind of overlap a bit, but what is your message to artists who are thinking about, or inspired, or businesses that want to collaborate? What is your main message, really briefly? There's a fine line, there's a way to do things. What is your message, I guess, to anyone wanting to take this on?
Well, even if you, even as a, a non-Native person, and you're looking to collaborate, or you're looking to work in a style that is, intrinsically Indigenous, it's not enough to just forge that relationship. That relationship has to keep going. It's not like a fly-in, fly-out deal, kind of deal. If you're looking to, like, if you really, truly, truly are inspired, and inspired means, like, the definition of inspired means to be touched by spirit, to be inspired. So if you are absolutely touched by spirit, it's not a one-day thing, it's not a one-week thing, it's not a retreat thing, it's a full-time friggin' thing. So, get ready for the long haul.
What was your, I guess, What's your final message to businesses, corporations, artists inspired that you want to do this? They know there's a fine line there. What is your main message, just wrapping everything up tonight?
I don't know, but I think quickly is writing down, you know, sincerity in engagement, reciprocal relationships, long-term engagement. Also going back to asking, like, why do you feel you need to do this? You know, what is the motivation? And truly be willing to step aside.
I think biggest thing is to look at the spirit and intent of why you want to do that project, or why you want to work with that certain person, or why you want to work with that certain style. And it's a question that you'll have to revisit, especially if it's a long project. You'll have to keep going back to that and, you know, figure out why you started doing it in the first place. And also, because, you know, the deeply, deeply ingrained thinking that we constantly have find ourselves correcting is to be not ready for those difficult decisions, but to understand that having harsh words, because I've had to have harsh words with non-Indigenous collaborators, that it's just something to think about, and that it'll happen often. And it's just because it's just the thinking that I'm challenging, not you, and not you as a person. That patriarchal, no, I got to go in and say that, or no, I got to go in and because I know better. And it's just trying to get rid of that thinking.
When I did my BFA, my main painting instructor was a classical painter, meaning that he loved the Renaissance painters, the classical European painters. He was Osage from Oklahoma. But he loved that work, he loved that style of painting. And so one of our typical assignments was to copy a masterpiece work. We had to pick a masterpiece and we had to reproduce it. And that's a classical exercise in learning how to see what the painter, the artist did. How did they use light? How did they create light and shadow? How did they create depth in that painting? How did they create drama? How did they create movement? And you'd learn how to do that by following and reproducing the work. But then you move on. You don't reproduce the work and then reproduce it in that style forever. And if you do reproduce a work in that, for that kind of an assignment, for that kind of reason, then acknowledge whose work it is you're reproducing. Don't just assume that everybody's going to say, oh, wow, that's a beautiful painting and it's yours. It doesn't work that way. So for me, that is about letting go of that sense of entitlement that you can do whatever you want and take whatever you want with no consequences. And that's a tough thing to say to people. Let go of your attitude. Let go of your entitlement. People don't like to hear that. They don't like a challenge. It's an uncomfortable place to be. But that's something that people have to do. If they're creating art in a style, they're using that art to learn, that doesn't mean they have the right to make art in that style for the rest of their lives.
Right on, that concludes our panel discussion. How about a big round of applause for you all? It takes a lot of courage to come up here and speak your mind to the crowd, so thank you so much, all four of you, for doing that. That leaves us to our break. We're going to have a 15-minute break, so if any of you are hungry or want some juice or whatever's back there, you can definitely get some. We're going to be taking a break for 15 minutes, and then back, and then we're going to do Q&A for another 45 or half an hour.
Thank you,
Chris. From Jenny. Okay, so that leads us to our Q&A for the night. So we'd love it with any of you in the audience would love to come up here to the mic in the middle here. You could line up whoever wants that has a question. You know, we've been talking about cultural appropriation. Probably many questions waving in the back of your mind as many of our panelists were talking this evening. So we have our first person to give their first question. So go ahead, introduce yourself, and we'll head through the question at our panelists.
Okay, panelists, first of all, thank you very much for coming out. It's been an absolutely fun, wonderful opportunity to hear you all speak on the topic. My name is Sarah. I've been an educator for a very long time now, and I do a lot of work with educating educators around appropriation. And I think we need to talk about, there's not very many conversations that are happening right now around the topic of appropriation within from Indigenous people themselves. I'll share an example. I talk constantly to educators around why it's inappropriate to make featherhead bands and featherhead dresses. And you go out to some of the sporting events and you see some of our own people wearing some of the headdresses. You know, the whole issue that happens around mascots and the naming of mascots. And then we have some of our own Indigenous communities naming their junior teams the Fighting Sioux and issues like that. So I'd like to hear some of your comments on that topic.
Thank you very much, Sarah. Whoever wants to answer that first.
I'll start. First of all, can I ask you, are you Indigenous? Are you First Nation or Métis? Yes? Okay. Okay, so that's something that I deal with regularly and talk about in my classes, is how our people are also appropriating other things. A good example is the dream catcher. Dream catchers are Anishinaabe. And there was a certain person in the family who made that dream catcher. And it was done for a specific reason. And now dream catchers are across North America, Canada and the States. And it's seen as a indicator of Indianness in some ways, right? And there's good intentions there, but it's still people appropriating other cultures. And it's because I think what's happened is it's a complex thing because of the colonization process. So we lost connection to our identity. And now we were trained to believe that indigenous cultures are a homogenous, one thing, one culture, one group, right? We're all Indian. But in fact, it's like, if there are over 600 nations in Canada, it's in North America, it's an international country, right? All those nations are, it's international. So what I think is happening is, because I've been studying it and trying to figure it out, is that it's an internal issue with our own people now trying desperately to find a way to connect to their indigenous side. And many don't know how. So that's what they do. Powwow is another one. Powwow is a pan-Indian thing. Powwow that we know today came from, has its origins in the Wild West shows. But it's become very spiritual to many, and it's been healing for many. And you find powwows not just in the Northern Plains where they supposedly originated, but in Alaska, in the Southwest, in Florida, all over. And those cultures didn't dance that way. They didn't gather that way. So for me, what I'm seeing is it's an internal issue about, and it's connected to finding, reconnecting to our identity. And it's something that we have to address. But I don't know that we're ready yet. And it is something that I talk about in my classes. So we have to start those discussions. But that's how I see it. I don't know if that answer helped you, but that's how I see it.
Anybody else?
Anybody else that wanted to touch that question? Okay, thank you very much, Audrey, for that. Go ahead and introduce yourself and go ahead and ask a question.
My name is Tamara. I'm an elementary school teacher. And my question is, how do we, as educators of young children, respectfully teach information like this that is important without being seen as appropriating? I mean, we teach cultures all around the world. We talk about traditions and celebrations in a variety of contexts in a way to encourage our students to be more aware of the world around them. And how do we, as educators that are non-Indigenous, do that? Because it isn't realistic to invite people from every single culture we want to talk about into our classroom all of the time. That's just not feasible.
Anyone Spanish that one? Have some words of advice.
I don't want to be rude.
You got me again. Sorry. Education is one of the areas too that needs work. I think that as educators, you have to engage the cultures, especially here. You have to engage them, and there are ways to engage them that won't cost a lot of money, but you still have to make that effort. You also, I think, should be lobbying your faculties to get more classes about Indigenous art and history, because I know that they don't have very many. I was brought in to teach a class at the U of S, and then I'm teaching an Indigenous art technique class to SUNTEP students, education students at the U of R. And typically, there's very little time spent on Indigenous art. And that art carries history. So you need to, I think that taking Native art history classes would help. As an instructor, you're already working. But lobbying the faculties of education at the universities to include that more will also make a difference. And when you can engage your community, engage the people that are there. You might have students whose parents could come and talk or help them with something or help you with something, help you figure out. But it's not gonna work if you don't approach, if you don't do the work to approach and learn. That's, I think. I think that's about what I have to say about that.
Thank you, Audrey. And I should also say, whoever is watching this on the internet, this is to you doing the live feed right now, whoever's watching this from your phone or your computer. If you have a question, you can comment under the feed, and we'll take a couple questions at the end, just when we're at the end of this here. So if anybody has a question online, you're welcome to ask as well. And we'll take the next question here.
I was thinking, usually what I say to people is when you consult, you bring somebody in, and I recognize the challenges, financial challenges, obviously, about always doing that. If you can't always bring an expert in, it's still your responsibility as an educator to consult, to work with community, to learn, to teach yourself. I think it's also a responsibility of the boards to hire more Indigenous experts within the school system, and then for their non-Indigenous allied teachers to also not depend on them to be the only ones to teach you. It's up to yourself to educate yourself. And I think there is ways to talk about other cultures and aspects of other cultures, because it's important that, it's obviously you're teaching it, because it's very important that we learn about one another and how to be with one another. And I think there's ways you can talk about these things and present these issues without appropriating, even starting from your own context about why you're talking about this, why this is important, how you relate to it, how you're implicated in these histories, and how we move forward together, and maybe frame it within discussions, not so much a talking at students and telling them about something else that you may not be from your area of expertise. If that helps.
Sorry, I'll just jump in too. Even though you say you can't bring everybody in, just keep kind of your ear to the ground and hear word of mouth and who other people bring in, because my partner Janine and I have been in schools talking about the Regina Indian Industrial School and screening. It's really nice when a classroom screens our work before we get there, so we don't have to sit through our 47-minute documentary all over again. But we have a whole lot of other artists who made shorts that, and one of the things that I really love about going into schools and talking to kids about this history is that they have such a natural sense of justice. And they can go home and tell their parents about what they're learning. And so education is a tool. So I find it's good that way that the children were taken away, but we can also reach the children and they can bring that to their parents.
much, panelists, and we'll take your questions. Apologies for holding.
That's fine. Hi, my name is Cassie Fisher, and my question is in regards to tattoos. There's been a resurgence in taking back traditional ways of tattooing. And I guess my question is, what's your take on Indigenous symbols being used in tattoos, as well as like taking into consideration like who's tattooing and who's getting the tattoo?
That was just in the back of my mind when you were talking about all this. I was like, tattoos.
Yeah, like does the person tattooing have to be Indigenous? Do they have to be influenced to that? And who's getting the tattoo, I guess?
Well, we all know the story of the yuppie or the, what are they called now, hipsters that that get the Chinese symbols and they don't even know what it is. So, you know, you could ask, I guess, you know, a lot of different nations or cultures what it feels like for them. I went to Aotearoa twice and I got, both times I got my moko, I got my tamako, so I got my tattoos, and it was by Indigenous people, and they were in their Indigenous designs that I was in consultation with the people to get, and you know, it's so there's an example of people who, you know, two Indigenous cultures that are engaging together and wanting to, you know, represent. And the reason why I wanted to get these tattoos is to say I was there. You know, I'm a Mohawk person, I was representing down there. And then I realized, oh shit, I should get tattoo from my nation. So then just last summer I got a tattoo from my nation by a Native tattoo artist from my region, Donnie Henhock. So, what do we think of that? I think that the resurgence of the traditional tattoo methods is a beautiful, beautiful thing. And it's no, like, you know, walk in the park. This, we're talking about the threading, you know, we're talking about like real stuff. I think that when people want to engage in that as a way to kind of show pride or whatever, that's beautiful. When I see, like, you know, the Australian tourist with his Sitting Bull, and this is real, I saw this, you know, with his Sitting Bull tattoo on his back, I engage. I ask him, hey, who is that on your back, Sitting Bull, blah, blah, blah. How come you got it? I think it's cool, blah, blah, blah. So, you know, it's on the person's skin, so what are you going to do? Not too much. But, you know, and we see that. So, I mean, yeah, there's elements of cultural appropriation there, clearly there are. Is it forgiving? I don't know. I think that's up to the individual. And, you know, again, I think it might be a good icebreaker to say, hey, why did you get that dream catcher on your thigh? Why did you, you know, get that Pocahontas or whatever the design is, to help understand. And then that's also the opportunity to educate, you know, to provide whatever insight, you know, you as an Indigenous person can provide to that person. Because a lot of the times I think it's, you know, tattoos is very tribal anyway to begin with, and to see people, you know, just getting that Tweety Bird on their skin, it's like, really? That's what you want to do with your skin? Or whatever, it sounds judgy, but I get why people want to go to those Indigenous designs, because it reinforces the tribal practice of tattooing. But it doesn't mean it's right.
I kind of feel I can't not answer that question, since it's very obvious I've got some tattoos. I'm just learning about, I'm still thinking about that in terms of tattoo practice. And sorry, I didn't see where you went to sit down.
Yeah, I can see you. There's
okay, thank you. I need a record. it's an interesting thing. I think tattoos are a form of self-expression. I've heard them also in the context of different Indigenous nations who have a practice of tattooing. You know, it's kind of like described as like a contemporary or a permanent regalia. And it is a way of expressing oneself. And I think they're very personal. People usually get them. They can be mnemonic devices. My
I've always wanted tattoos. I don't know why. I should need to think about that a little bit more. But I've always liked the aesthetics of it. But my first tattoo wasn't until I was 36 years old, for lots of reasons. And I found a lot of thought has gone. I should say a lot. I would like to say a lot of thought has gone into what I've gotten, but it hasn't. I found myself on doing these studio visits recently. There is a group out in the West. I was just in Columbia last week. So Dion Cassis has been working with some other contemporary artists, Amy Malbouf, Jordan Bennett. To kind of look at these practices, and it is complex. Not every nation in North America had a tattoo practice, but it does exist, and I didn't even know if there was practices here. So I like this sense that it is part of this continuum. People are researching this. It is another art form. I just, this one's fresh. I just got this Thursday because Well, this one started with a studio visit to Dion, and we started talking about culture and what I needed at the time, and I meant to just learn more about the practice and what he's doing to try and understand it, and then, I'm there, and you want to get some ink? It's like, okay, and we talked about it. So it became something about a relationship, and it is different, I think, when you establish a relationship, you're exchanging something, you're receiving something from somebody within the context of learning. This other one, the canvas, didn't show up for that day, so I got a text, we sit in. It's like, well, maybe, who's doing it? It's like, oh, Jerry Evans. It's like, oh, master printmaker? Mi'kmaq printmaker? Yeah, of course I'm going to sit in. I need to do a studio visit with him anyway. So I don't mean to, make light of it, but I do think, I have put some thought to what I'm getting, and I have thought, am I appropriating? Some of these symbols aren't necessarily from my culture. This one isn't. It's about my daughter. I am appropriating. It's about her tri-Indigenous heritage. So I am appropriating from my husband's background. It's Aztec and Mayan background because that's in my daughter. So yeah, it's a gray area. Am I appropriating? Yeah. these ones, I was gifted from Jerry. There's a symbol from his background, and the rest he's referencing my background. So it was much of an exchange and a conversation. Now I just feel like I'm talking about myself and showing off my tattoos. So I don't know if I'm answering your question, but I'll just leave it at that.
Anybody else have anything on that? Does that answer your question?
Can I answer?
Yeah, go ahead. Okay.
So again, back to my teaching. I did a lot of research on Indigenous tattooing traditions because my son challenged me when I was getting all judgy about the tattoos he was getting. He was a teenager. And I learned some amazing stuff. And I learned one of the things was that how extensive tattooing traditions were in the Americas before European contact. I watched Ink Master faithfully. I love that show. And get all judgy with that too. But there was one season where a woman from California, I think she was Hispanic, Tattoo Baby was her name, she made it to the finals somehow, and she did this full back tattoo of a stereotypical Indian head, which with the feathers and that really bugged me. That's the kind of tattooing I don't like. The stereotypical kind that is it romanticizes. And I don't know how to stop that. I don't know how to tell people. And like Janet said, it's on their skin, what are you gonna do, right? So it's a dichotomy, it's a complex thing. It's not easy to navigate through and gives you lots to think about.
I hope that answered your question, yeah, pretty much. So we'll take the next one there. Come on down.
Hi, my name is Savannah. Something that I've kind of struggled with thinking about for a while, and I'm hoping you guys can maybe speak to this and help me make sense of it. It's kind of really maybe a gray area as well. So what happens when Indigenous musicians use hip-hop or traditionally African-American music in their musically. That's something that I'm kind of struggling to understand. when that's okay, and if it's because of a shared history of oppression, or what makes that, you know, if you can speak to that, that'd be really great. That's my question.
Yeah, I was doing a radio show for 10 years, Data Waves Radio, and there was a lot of Native hip-hop that came across my desk, and I played maybe 10% of it. And the reason for that is because I didn't, for the genre itself, I haven't found that hip-hop as a genre, generally speaking, has moved on to anything new or interesting or different. So it's kind of just, you know, been like that. And the fact that not only Native people really glommed onto the hip-hop genre, but there's Spanish hip-hop, there's French hip-hop, there's, you know, Yugoslavian hip-hop, like there's all kinds of nationalities and nations doing hip-hop. And I think, and again, it's just an opinion, but you know, when people see, feel, hear, taste something that's real, that's based in something really real, then they want a part of that. And I think that there are some parallels in the content of the hip hop that was being originally produced. You're talking about your hardships, you're talking about injustices. It's very straight, very urban content, and it's word-based. So let's bring it back to a word-based practice, hip hop, generally speaking. And then it's telling stories. And so I think there's another parallel with indigenous practice and methods, you know, artistic creative methods, is that it's, when you break it down, it's stories, it's poetry, you know, and I think that there was a draw in that regard. And then it's just groovy beats, you know, it's very enjoyable, but some of it can come across as very angry as well, and I think that, again, that's just something that indigenous people can relate to. Let's look at, okay, so if we're focused on just Native hip-hop, there's a lot of parallels, of course, culturally speaking, of Native people, between Native people and Black people. I mean, we share a lot of history, and it comes a lot from the East Coast, but generally speaking, there's a lot of parallels there. So I'm not surprised that genre of music was so embraced by the new Native musicians coming up. Is it right? Is it wrong? I don't know. I can't say. But like I said, as a person who had a radio show and had the choice, a vast choice of music to play, I only really thought that 10% of it was really any good to play. So it happens. It surely does. Right or wrong, it happens.
Any other panelists want to talk about that?
I have a question about it.
Audrey?
I have a question about it too. Like, why? How is that not copyright infringement? I don't know. I don't understand that. So
the genre.
Well, when they take cuts from other pieces and incorporate it into the music.
Sampling.
Right. Yeah. I don't. I'm not a musician. I'm an artist, but I know that if somebody's art was taken, it would be copyright infringement. So how is that not the same when it comes to music? And it's an area that I don't know much about, so I can't really speak to.
But I have
lots of questions about it.
Anybody else have any questions in the audience that would like to come up and share their thoughts? Dasha?
Hi, I'm Natasha. Thank you for coming this evening. I have a question regarding, I guess what you could call wearable art, earrings, any form of clothing, purses, etc. I'm non-Indigenous, and I appreciate them as an art form. I've always felt very uneasy purchasing that as gifts for non-Indigenous people or wearing it myself. And I'm curious what you think about that from an appropriation standpoint, and whether that falls into what we're discussing this evening.
Well, you kind of answered your own question. If you're uneasy about it, then don't do it.
Anybody else?
Sure. Say something.
So there's another, it's a dichotomy. It's nice to know that people, that non-Native people appreciate and value our aesthetics. And as long as you're purchasing it from Indigenous artists And it's a sincere purchase and gift, and wearing it in with respect, I don't see a problem with it. But you have to make sure that it's coming from Indigenous artists. And a big part of our issues come from non-Native people learning how to make our things and then taking off and making them and selling them. And in a lot of those instances, the images, they're bastardized. And that is really incredibly offensive when you see like the Inuit medicine person's coat on the runway in Europe. That's really offensive and it's hurtful. So I don't see that there's a problem as long as you're purchasing it from, I think it's okay. I don't see it as appropriation if you're purchasing it and wearing it with respect. Yeah.
So yeah, I'm just going to add something to that, and that is, you know, it's. I think we give our power out over too easily, and that is to, you know, you're asking us, is that okay? And you think, you know, you're already in your gut, you don't feel right about it, and you know, I think we can do that with a lot of art and culture that's out there. Check your gut, because you're going to be able, if something is authentically produced and comes from a very authentic place, you're gonna be able to feel that. Like, trust yourself. You're really gonna be able to feel that. You're gonna be able to hear the soul in the music. You're gonna be able to get the message that's coming from that painting, or really feel the energy coming off of a piece of writing or a piece of poetry or something. You really can. You can be your own gauges of authenticity. You really can. Trust that.
Paulette,
who made the artwork outside.
Yes,
Madame, thank you for coming and speaking on behalf of this really important topic. It's a hot topic, and we have a lot of trolls patrolling this topic beforehand. It's really interesting how we had to see that happen. But my question to you, and it's something that sits raw within inside of me, as Dakota Shehea, is traveling and going to museums and seeing our artifacts, our ceremonial sacreds in territories where it doesn't belong, and then the communities asking for their ceremonial items to return home. What are your thoughts? Thank you.
I think about Poundmaker, which was in the news just recently. If anybody wants to, any of the panelists want to talk about that or share their thoughts.
Repatriation is a process and a system made by non-Indigenous people, so there you go.
Tell it like it is, eh?
Well, I think Audrey said it a couple times before, you know, give us our stuff back.
Give us our stuff back.
It's really tough seeing that. It makes you cry. And what you see in the, it just wrenches your gut, your heart. And sometimes it even debilitates you. When you go into a museum and you see what's out there and you're heartbroken, that's nothing compared to what they have in their collection is. There are billions of objects in museums, collections, all over the world that belong to the peoples in the Americas. And like I said earlier, every one of those pieces is a mnemonic device that connects us to our identity, our culture, and our place. But there's the issue of colonial law, property law, and possession is 9/10 of the law. And for the non-Native community, especially the museums who have designated themselves as stewards of our cultures, stewards of humanity, I didn't give anybody the right to claim they were stewards of my family's history, holding them And I see those objects as being held hostage. They're in jail because they're living, breathing objects. So when you see those pieces in those museums and galleries, it's really tough, it's hard in the heart. And I've said a lot of prayers. I've been in a lot of situations where the people that I'm with, the other museum people, the other cultural tribal people from different nations in North America, we've prayed, we've cried, we've looked for ways to make them let go of our ancestors and bring them home, so we can bring them home. And one of those institutions is the Smithsonian, the National Museum of the American Indian. They say that they work with the native people, but what they do is they let the native people come in and connect with their objects, and they film it. And they don't let the people take those objects home. They film it, and then it goes into their archives. And they maintain that position that they're the stewards of history, of our history. So repatriation is a big issue. It's a big thing that's going to take a long, long time to get through. And you just have to keep saying prayers. And when I go into places like that, I say a prayer. And I say, I'm sorry. I'm sorry I can't take you home. Those objects are who we are. And that's why when somebody from outside our culture appropriates our work and doesn't give any consideration at all to the meaning of it, that's why we get upset.
There's a really great documentary that I'd actually really like to bring to Regina from Rapanui, which is the indigenous name for Easter Island. And it's a story that's, once again, like Ingrid and I'm told from the community. And this man documents his father's desire to go to England to see, because they took one of those big Easter Island heads. Like, it wasn't just the head, there's actual body underneath. You really learn a whole lot about how these Easter Island heads aren't just decorative. They're actually really very sacred to the people there, and just what it meant for his father and to go and visit it with his daughter. So it was a father and granddaughter who went on this big quest to go to I can't remember the name of the museum, but some big museum in England that housed it. And it's really quite interesting, it's very powerful, and he causes a little bit of a ruckus in the museum. But come see me after and I'll find the title for you. But like I said, it's something that I would really like to bring here, because I think it would be really interesting for people to see.
Thank you very much, panelists. We got about 2 minutes left. Do we have any questions, Chris?
Got one,
yes. We're not forgetting about you online.
The internet.
They're waiting, so we'll let Chris ask the question.
This one comes from Andrea Martino. I believe she's still online. And I quote, I'll just quote what she said. She says, I have a few Indigenous friends. I've had a few Indigenous friends invite me to powwows and have been to panels with speakers like Carol Johnson, where non-Indigenous people have been encouraged to attend powwows in other Indigenous communities. Do you have any advice for non-Indigenous people who have been invited to these spaces for the first time? For example, how to respectfully observe and participate while learning more about the culture? Thank you, and thank you for the question.
Thank you for that question.
Well, think about how you would behave if you got invited to anyone's house, how would you behave? That's how you behave at a powwow. You behave respectfully. You don't get in the way. You don't steal stuff. Just think of it like that. Like if someone is giving you permission, actually inviting you to go. And I think that's a misconception too, that non-Native people think that they have to wait to be invited to go to power. No, these are public events that you can go and enjoy the cultural celebration that powwows are. And so just think of it like that. If someone has invited you to go to their grandma's house, how would you behave? That's how you behave at powwow.
Any other panelists? I think that's the last question we have for the night. Any other ones? All right.
Don't wear headdress.
Oh, Janet said don't wear a headdress as well. All right. Well, we'll leave it there. How about a big round of applause for all these folks? Thank Janet Rogers, Michelle LaVallee, Trudy Stewart, and Audrey Drever for sharing their thoughts with us tonight. We'd also like to thank our sponsors, the Federation of Sovereign Indigenous Nations, ResX and City of Regina, Sagamawak, Sask Culture, Saskatchewan Arts Board, and Sask Writers Guild one more time. Thanks to Keith Bird, who gave us the opening remarks and prayer as well. Thank you, Keith. Where is he? Did he leave? Oh, luck. Okay. Please stick around for our live music. Like we said, it's $20 at the door. And don't forget, Janet has some books at the front as well, and you're welcome to purchase them as well. Thank you all for coming here today.